Okay, so I might be one of the few people here that's not a tech writer. I'm a writer about tech. I'm a storyteller. I do the translation work from the technical side to the non-technical side. And this is really perfect because I do a lot in the agile space, and I do a lot in the API space. So it just made sense to bring them together. So how many people here actually are working in agile and doing documentation? Are you part of the agile cycle? Is the documentation part of the agile cycle? Okay. Do you get pushback sometimes from the agile team that documentation isn't important, they just need to release? Anybody? That was a lot of hands that went up for the video people watching later. So I can never decide on titles of talks, so I've got four. So we have first represented by the most agile and vicious of these, the hippo. How can API documentation become inherently agile? How can you foster a culture that gets your developers excited about documentation? How can you foster a culture that gets your developers that you're working with excited about pleasing their customers? And then how are you going to convince your agile teams that documentation is important and that it actually adds value to speed, not the opposite, that it slows things down? So today the game plan is we're going to start talking about why documentation is important. Obviously you guys are sold on that, but what is important about API documentation? Why does it come off as inherently unagile? Where's that stereotype from? Because I disagree. I think documentation is inherently agile if it's done correctly. We're going to talk about, because I'm a storyteller, I'm going to tell the story of a waterfall to agile transformation, a really interesting Kanban transformation using Rice, which I recommend to everybody. It's a free algorithm or Excel formula, I guess is a better way to describe it, that Intercom created, that anyone can use, and a different company used it, and it's a very helpful way to prioritize what they document. Scrum transformation, and then touch on a little bit about automation, continuous documentation, document first, and then who's in charge of the documentation. But I guess we can guess who you guys think should be in charge of the documentation. So why do people think that documentation isn't agile? Just start yelling out, and I might repeat for the viewers later what you say. So why do people, what pushback do you get about documentation?
Takes additional time.
Yeah, takes additional time.
Working software over documentation.
Working software over documentation, though if you can't document it, it probably is not very functioning software, right?
I think sometimes they don't necessarily see how
yes, it's about them throwing it over the edge from we did something, now you write about it, but you're saying, advocating it's more about the change management and the impact that it comes about, yeah.
Rework and dropping the features can lead to wasted time on writing stuff that doesn't end up in the product.
Okay, so it might be that people think that you're documenting something that won't even end up in the product. Which, that's true, you probably shouldn't be documenting something that could be in the product, but they have to communicate that with you, right? Fantastic. Thank you guys for helping me do my job here today. Please continue. Why are docs rejected? People just think it's because waterfall was so documented, they think documentation, agile is the opposite of waterfall, which it's not usually really, let's be serious, but that means agile is the opposite of documentation. It's silly, but it's valid. It feels very top-down management. There's never enough time. This is a valid thing if you are just throwing it over the edge and people then want to release it. But obviously we know that's not when your tech writer should be involved to pick up the scraps at the end. It's kind of boring. If you're going to see a theme throughout, I'm not saying your jobs are boring. I'm saying that developers think this is boring. I actually think that more and more developers should be hands-on with documentation, so you're going to see that theme a lot. And there's a lack of ownership, and then I love calling it the hot potato syndrome. It's same with testing. It's not my problem. I don't want to have to do it. You throw it to someone else, throw it to someone else. So obviously I'm a storyteller, so I'm not quoting myself a lot. Hot potato, I think I made up, but in general. So it depends if you're really working on an agile team. I worked on an agile team where everybody could wear what they wanted to work, and we had stand-ups every morning. I did not work for an agile team. So the truth of the matter is you might not be working on an agile team anyway. people just throw it over and the recipients of wisdom. I will post this on SlideShare and tweet it out so you don't have to read the whole slides. And as Arnaud, who I think you guys know pretty well from the community, our API handyman, says that if it's done without control, we still have many microservices that don't speak the same language. So yeah, we have this whole world where we have containers and microservices that are giving this autonomy, but then what's the point if they're not working together? Yes, we want autonomy, but we want to create a story, especially for our users, especially for our API consumers. And the number one thing people want isn't registering. This is the head of a technical writer company. It's a really good company, Synergist Tech. If you're looking for some extra side work or something, I would definitely recommend working with them. And it is legitimately, I think the only statistic I've seen was from 2013, but Programmable Web did a study, and actually the number one thing that came up that API developers and API consumers specifically wanted, and what was their main point of decision making, was the documentation. So they're doing that, they're considering that. So that's the number one thing they're looking for. Why, especially in the API space, is this not happening? It makes no sense, right? So what's the case for API documentation that you can make? It cuts customer support, it affects decision making. As we said, it's the most important thing. It shows you actually give a crap about developer experience. It shows that there's internal efficiency, and it creates internal efficiency, it accelerates developer onboarding. It's probably the only way to really unite this new fragmented world that we're so excited about, containers and microservices, and everything in between. Yeah, it's exciting that developers have more of a say and are more powerful in this world, but then why don't they just all work for separate companies and we all have, we each download a microservice from our phone. No, that's not how it works. So everything has to work together and you become the curator of that world, I think, in this new idyllic world of agile documentation I envision. If you're documenting it, it actually does lead to simpler code because people are talking about it, and if they go on and on and on and on, like I sometimes do, that's not something you want to actually document, right? It's probably something you need to cut down. It allows you to prototype, write spec first. This is the whole behind API first. And then Agile has, everybody talks about what the ideal Agile is, but when it comes down to it, Agile is supposed to be about collaboration. So if documentation is done right, it's about a collaborative project. It's the ability, this is obviously the creator or inventor of Swagger. It's the ability to modify the thing that drives the whole process at every stage of development. Doesn't that make you feel a little powerful? Think about it. You have the ability to do all of this for every stage of the development if the Agile team cares enough to get you involved, and they should from the beginning. So what makes for good API documentation? We talked about a lot of stuff today, but what do we got? Come on, start yelling out. What makes good API documentation? Just yeah.
Like if you can combine some storytelling and structural stuff with code and surface that code that people can read.
Okay, storytelling and code together.
And trying it out, like really getting hands-on.
Very getting very hands-on.
Yeah.
Trying, so the developers should be testing the documentation too?
Well they should. I think they would love to look on a documentation page and just click a button and make a successful call and then have it build like immediate confidence.
Okay, build immediate confidence by allowing the developers to be able to click and make a call right away. Absolutely, that's definitely what's right.
I think one of the key things is to help customers on their entire journey and not just like on the troubleshooting. So docs should not just be API reference docs. It should be like, you know, taking you from what does this thing do anyway to all the way to, okay, I've successfully done this now. How can I share it with my friends and celebrate that's I've done something interesting.
Taking a customer on a journey from what is the documentation about or what is the API about, which I find missing a lot in documentation, especially as a marketer and from an SEO standpoint, all the way to the end of making a successful call. This is interesting because I loved Andrew Seward's talk a couple years ago in Barcelona API Days, because he was talking about marketing APIs, especially internally within a company. And you guys need to market your documentation. he asked everyone to talk, tell the person next to them in 1 minute about their API. Everyone started talking about, well, it's written in Java, it's written in this, it's written in that. No one said what their API did. Guess what? People are Googling for your API. Your documentation's your SEO. I don't care. They're maybe GitHub, but mainly they're Googling for your API. So you should have what your API is about at the very top in describing your API. Good documentation is simple to the point. It is very personal. It talks about you. It goes to your major marketing personas. I look at documentation because I'm a marketing background as a part of your marketing. It's searchable, even if it's just Control or Command F. That's what we do in life. That's what we're used to, everything we do. How do I answer those questions? If I Google that, I'm more likely to Google how do I put these things together than, or how do I integrate these things, than actually go into your documentation, search for it. So put headlines of how do I do that. That's how we Google, that's how we work. It's continuous, that means you're continuously updating, which I'm guessing most of you, since you have pushback from your agile teams, it's not really happening. It involves the consumer in planning the documentation, which was a great thing when we talked about gov.uk. And it's just welcoming, interactive, you're up to date with versioning. These are things we've talked about all day. How often is it actually getting done? And that's because we're not, as documentation people, or as technical writers or writers about tech, advocating enough within our company to be agile and part of the agile cycle. And of course, we know it's filled with examples, which is what people want. It's about keeping it in sync with the evolving API design. Continuous is part of the broader life cycle. You have to remember it's about API learning, integration, feedback. It's about being part of customer support. If I can't describe it and I'm working around something in the documentation, then I need to fix something in the code. This is why developers have to be involved in documentation and early on, or else the code's going to be all spaghetti up in there. So here's how WorldPlay went from waterfall to agile. They had developers in 4 countries, and they just had APIs nobody wanted to use. So this seems very similar to what gov.uk did. They started surveying customers. They worked with customer service, asking them, what are the questions you get all the time? They were very following lean, not just agile, but very lean processes. What were wastes in the process that they were trying to get rid of? They then did 2 full in-company workshops, not just for the documentation team, and they introduced these user personas they discovered, and then they talked about how you can map customer journeys, and then they looked at their competitors, what they were doing, and clearly if your competitor's Stripe, you better be looking at the API documentation. And then they said, where do they need documentation, what kind of documentation they want, what are the pain points? That was part of their customer journey. This is the simple background of a customer journey. And then she said, people usually look at documentation when they have a problem, or if it's API when they want to integrate. So their first priority is always creating an FAQ and integration documentation. Now SendGrid used Rice, which is really interesting. So SendGrid started out as they went agile maybe 2 years ago now. They had 2-week sprints. They just had this huge document debt. How many people have doc debt? That's it, really. I'm surprised. Maybe if a quarter of the room, if they're listening, admit they have doc debt. That means we have a lot of people on top of it. That's impressive. Okay. They were doing a lot of reactionary documentation. Oh, we're getting a lot of calls about this, or, okay, no, you have to document this right now. We're just releasing this feature, so that created more docs debt. They were constantly changing their priorities, and they weren't prioritizing in any way for business impact. They were basically just doing what they were told, and they weren't able to really manage their documentation process and take charge of it. So they got the Rice formula, which is reach times impact times confidence divided by effort. So this is something, if you search Rice and Intercom, it's a blog post about it. It's extremely useful. And I would recommend it. It's a very simple Excel spreadsheet formula, and it just gives you the highest score, gets top billing. It's extremely transparent. You get it done using the Scrum term of done, and it solves for urgencies, it solves for the size of the project. So maybe a smaller project might float up that you were always putting off because you're like, oh, that doesn't seem that important, the formula might decide it's that important, and you guys didn't think so. And it's just prioritizes the whole Kanban backlog. So they've fiddled with the formula a bit more, and they've added for business imperative and due date. So they've created their own, SendGrid has created their own level of rice, but just with this combination, they've been able to cut down extremely. So they have docs teams got 50% velocity increase in 1 month, and then the open source team, twice the velocity in 1 week by just following this, because it really gets logical things. There were no more constant updating priorities. 3 lines of Excel instead of a backlog in Jira, and then everyone in the team knows about it. Everyone knows what's happening, and nobody questions what is coming next. Why is this not that important? Because it's not a business priority, so it's not getting done, or it's 22nd versus, oh, it's next week, you can just say. So it takes away any judgment or decision making from it. So next, this is if you want to go Scrum. How many are Scrum here? How many, or maybe work with Scrum teams? Okay, about half the room, okay. So can you do agile documentation with Scrum? This was a really interesting talk at a different API the Docs conference, because should documentation equal done? I think usually it should in the API space. Done is the final of Scrum. So you might be able to do Scrum if you start early, you sit side by side, you don't have documentation in another room, or if you're remote, you have them constantly in your Slack channel or whatever you're using to communicate, that it's continually updated, that your documentation you can't ship it. If you're saying it's done equals documented, you can't ship it unless it's documented then, which makes it a lot of everything. So I think what's really interesting that Rob offered was a couple questions that you need to ask yourself. And this is about deciding whether you guys are in charge of it or you are part of the Scrum process, that maybe you curate the documentation, but the developers are in charge of documenting their own stuff, and then maybe you curate and make it better. I keep using the word curate because I think it's the best term. Like, you are artists, so why not? So can anyone other than the tech writer complete the documentation tasks? What percentage do you think of your team can complete, of other people besides you could complete documentation tasks?
Varies so much with mine.
It varies, okay, but a range of percentage. Yeah, do you feel some of your developers could document?
Definitely less than half.
Less than half, okay. Why do you not have confidence in the ability to develop, to document?
It's more that they lack confidence. I think they sometimes feel like we have these like magic word skills or something. And I'm often like, actually, you guys are really good writers. Like, go with it. Like, go for it. Open a PR, you know?
Okay, so it's a confidence thing where a lot of your developers maybe are not native English speakers, and let's face it, English is the language of documentation. Typically, and they feel like they can't write well enough. Doesn't actually matter, does it? They just need to write the code. You're there to help fix it up a bit, make it pretty. Their name's not getting, it represents the whole team, not an individual saying, oh, that person doesn't know how to spell that word. It doesn't work, but that's a good point, yeah. So, anybody else? Do you have developers involved in your documentation writing? Would you like to? Yeah?
Yeah, all devs do write docs.
All devs do write docs?
Not all.
Oh, our devs. Oh.
Yeah.
Your developers write the docs, so that's great. Okay. But that wasn't a lot of hands that went up just for the later audience. Said that. What portion of the docs can be finished quickly by a tech writer? So if this is comparing if you're a semi-functional or a single-functional team. Because if you're a single-functional team, you can't be Scrum. You're sharing these, you have multiple roles and stuff. And a team. So if you have more than 75% is done by a single tech writer, you're probably not going to be able to go to the Scrum. So you can just fall asleep during the rest of this part of the talk. Is the documentation consistently high quality? Is there only one deliverable? Do you have a docs guide, standards, and templates? As a writer and a marketer, I love style guides. I really recommend them. Even for yourself to remember sometimes what the style is that you're following, really recommend it. Does your team enhance your documentation at all? Can they add benefit? Maybe you guys are the ones doing all the enhancing, but maybe let them go back and try it out. Testing team, QA is a really good team to bring and get involved in this, because they can test if the documentation still makes sense. They can build their test cases against documentation and vice versa. They can build the test case, they can build the examples in the documentation. If you have yes to most of these, then probably you could, your Scrum, you can be Scrum as well, and documentation meaning done. But you have to remember, documentation should not be the part of the software development process that causes you to not get done. So if it's the thing that's holding you back, you shouldn't be using Scrum and documentation. So how can docs fuse with Agile? You guys, I believe you should become the curators. You should be creating a style guide, but then you should be getting your developers involved in creating documentation. How do you automate the documentation processes, create a process you can duplicate, and automate it so you don't miss anything. You want to automate as much as possible, then also developers won't be as bored and consider it boring, because, yeah, developers hate repeated tasks. We all do. We're not robots. Until they take over, we need to automate as much as possible or use the robots to do the automation just so that we don't get bored. Markdown spell check is a really interesting tool that we misspell things a lot, and that breaks the code. So why not use something? Or even, I'm an American living in England. A lot of the stuff I write is considered misspelled, especially with the OR. You guys do a lot of OUR and other, an S instead of a Z or Z, as you guys say. So these matter. You have to have a style guide. Even British to American translation work. You need some sort of quick reference list that people can just update, and it helps empower the developers to know what they're doing so you don't have to do it all the time. I also recommend you can edit with the developer with you one time. I think this is a really valuable thing, that they know what you're editing, and so they won't make the repeat mistakes. It's a good bonding experience. It's kind of like pair editing, we could call it. And it's very agile too, isn't it? Sitting next to each other, work remotely. Any type of code example testing, and of course, screenshots, creating screenshots and adding them in, people love them. That's all stuff that can be automated. One of the things that we quickly realized, we couldn't have live documentation that lived apart from the code. It had to live directly alongside of it, or it was automatically out of date. So remember that. You want to automate as much as possible. This was a great one, the DRY principle. Don't repeat yourself. So make that a rule in your company, in your documentation. Documentation takes discipline. The pieces of the changing things like containers and microservices make documentation less likely, and actually it becomes more necessary. So start arguing and advocating for this. And agile documentation makes better teams. If everyone owns their piece of their code, then they're only talking about it. The code's simpler. It's more explanatory. I don't want to say self-explanatory, because code is not self-explanatory, but it's more explanatory. And individual developers can still be creative, but they have to be communicative as well. So I'm asking you guys, now what are you going to take back today, and maybe today hopefully beer, but tomorrow to hopefully get your agile coaches and your agileists on board for documentation? Absolutely, yeah. These are best practices that were examples, but you do have to apply to your own organization.
Like, for example, just as a kind of a quick case study, like, I work for, like, maybe, like, a fairly large organization, and we have, like, very low-level procedure. So development teams, I don't know what they're all, like, they probably all use it in different flavors of delivering APIs, but who knows how they got to that point. So, like, I'm not sure how we can plug in successfully.
So the question was, he works for a fairly large company, and he doesn't know what the other agile teams are doing, what the other API teams are doing, and things like that. Ask to sit with them once a week. agile coaches, if they have an agile coach, will just love it. They just eat the shit up. Like, just try to join in. They'll love that you're pair programming with them for the day or working with them, and just ask them questions or buy pizza. That works for everybody, right? Just ask them directly.
Do you think though that, that then requires there to be like a lot of bodies in the tech docs department to sit and vet all these different teams?
Does that require a lot of bodies in the tech docs department? Not necessarily, because people, you'll find that once you do it once, people will start coming to you, I think. And it starts spreading. So yes, the first time it does, the first or second time you're gonna sit with teams, I think it does take more effort. But then you start spreading the word. Just advertise more. It's just about being more communicative as a company, which does take balls.
Right.
It's bold. It's a bold thing to do, but I think it's worth it. Anybody else?
I've worked in purely agile companies, and I've worked in companies where just the mention of the word agile makes the company totally unproductive. So I think agile documentation is part of the agile process, and ideally I would say you would document before you do development and continue documenting and enhance the documents. When you work in a company that is pure, strictly not agile, and if you start talking about agile, people just shut down and they stop becoming productive in the way that they are. Without mentioning agile, you just have to tell people that everyone should be brave, open themselves up to criticism, release documents regularly, and pretend it's not even about agile to some extent, and then slowly move them towards it in a more stealthy manner.
Someone's had the agile Kool-Aid. So he's talking about if you work for an agile company, you want to then say that you have to advocate for documentation first, writing the spec up front and just getting involved. And on the other side, if you work for an agile phobic company, don't use the A word. Just don't. And then work through everything and try to get people about just working together and communicating better, which I think is a great point. A great point to end on. Thank you very much, everybody.